Mic check, mic check. This is Tony and Chelsea live. You're here every Thursday at 5. Moment, because we started the show and then realized we weren't. So
we're not on
this
our
is a little
A-game.
Groundhog Day for us. We're not on our A-game today.
But yeah. I will say this incredibly discombobulated episode is brought to you by Squarespace. As you all know, the easiest way to create a beautiful website, blog, online store, portfolio. It's beautiful, right? They have 24/7 customer support. And so far, we've really liked them. You can go to squarespace.com and you get a free trial for 14 days. No credit card needed.
Squarespace.com/Tony.
And use the coupon code PHOTONEWS and get 10% off of your entire purchase.
Yeah, we both use Squarespace for our portfolios and we love it. But they can host any type of website, pretty much. Portfolios are just an easy way to do it. There are a couple of ways to communicate with us today. If you're on Twitter, you can tweet us at #TCLive. And our producer here, Justin, we'll throw it up on the screen. If he thinks you're funny or entertaining.
Or if he dislikes you.
And if you're watching live, you can write a comment and our screener, Siobhan, out in Philly, can read us your questions or comments. That's a great way to ask me questions, Chelsea questions, Justin questions, or better yet, our guest, Daniel. Daniel Lowe, time-lapse photographer. You can find out more about him at starmountainmedia.com. We were just chatting a little bit, Daniel, but sounds like you've been, how long have you been doing time-lapse photography for?
Since 2009. Yeah, it's when I got started.
I bet a lot has changed since then. 2009 was a forever ago in the world of photography.
Mostly with the night stuff, the cameras like the Sony and the Canon 6D that are significantly better than before.
Yeah.
The basics have not especially changed, though. Everything's more affordable. There's a lot more sliders and different gadgets and things.
Yeah, I was just thinking about the memory cards in particular have really changed in those 6 years, and time lapses can eat through a lot of memory cards. Brings up a good question. Do you shoot JPEG or RAW when you do a time lapse?
I'm always shooting RAW, especially at night. But I'd shoot RAW anyway because the white balance, I want to get that just right, you know, later on. It's not really for resolution or another reason. It's really for the white balance.
Yeah, I would normally shoot RAW for that kind of thing too, though lately I've been using the 5DSR, which has these massive, massive RAW files, which, especially if you shoot a time lapse for a few hours and I think we got 900 photos for a time lapse when we were in Niagara Falls this past weekend. And it takes up just a massive amount of space, like shooting 4K video or something. So I was thinking about JPEG. That's kind of why I asked. It was just a question I wanted to know the answer to. I don't know if you can see it, but Justin's playing some of your clips right now, so you guys can get a chance to look at some of Daniel's pretty amazing work. Really, really stunning time lapses. I'm sorry, Daniel.
Go ahead.
You mentioned the Canon 6D. Is that your preferred camera?
I've had a Canon 70 and a 5D Mark II, the 5D Mark II is very, very good. Used that for 4 or 5 years. The 6D is just sort of the logical next. You know, I've got all these Canon accessories and lenses, so I didn't want to step off the Canon line entirely. I did have a Nikon D600 for a while, which was fine. It was a fine camera. The Nikons are very good during the day. The Canon is just a little bit better after dark. The Sony, of course, the A7S is even better than that. But the 6D is a great camera for all around landscape photography.
Yeah, I agree.
You know, it's a good resolution. It has excellent night performance, but it also has excellent day performance.
Yeah, the focusing at night on that thing is great. And I love it. It's one of the few cameras that has a built-in GPS, which especially for landscape stuff, I always just found terribly useful. It's too bad more cameras don't have it. We'll be taking a look at your time lapses during the course of the show. You can go to northrop.photo/submit. That's a different URL and it's a different tool. We want your time lapses to be in 1080p, 100 megabytes or less than 100 megabytes, and please no more than 30 seconds. We had some people submit them ahead of time since it's kind of a big deal, but submit them if you can, get them trimmed down to less than 100 megabytes, and we'll take a look at them over the course of the live show. And
next
we'll come back
week,
to Daniel. But
our photo theme is action, so we want to see movement. We want it to be exciting. Be our normal submission at northrop.photo/submit.
I love this picture you have, Chelsea. This is, you took that at the MoMA, right?
Yeah.
Did you use a tripod for that, or did you just hand hold
No,
it?
just handheld.
Pretty long exposure for a hand
Well,
holding.
I sat down on a bench and then I just put it on my knee.
That's kind of one of my favorite pastimes too, is seeing how long of an exposure I can get handheld.
It's not
With
my
good in
pastime, but I do that.
I like to challenge myself like that. A good lens with image stabilization and or especially in-body image stabilization or some combination of both. Sometimes you can get more than a set full second handheld and you can get pretty awesome effects without using a tripod. I wanted to quickly plug Northrop.photo, our own website and store and stuff. I wanted to mention it because we're going to be raising the prices of the bundle there this week.
Yeah, we kind of kept our sale prices up forever.
Yeah, we just forgot. Anyway, so those bundle prices where you get three books or the everything bundle, you'll see them on the site. Those prices are your last chance. Go to Northrop.photo. I had some more questions for you, Daniel. Earlier, we were talking about this a little bit, but how long do you typically shoot a time lapse for?
I'm usually not thinking in terms of a amount of time that I want to capture as many as much as that I want to capture. So typically, what I'll think is you are going to animate at some frame rate, let's say 24 frames a second or 30 frames a second. That's typically one of the two frame rates you're going to use. When you're out shooting, if you know that already, that means you're going to need 240 frames for 10 seconds of video. For any kind of video, anything shorter than 6 seconds is almost not usable. You know, it's just so fast of a cut unless you're going to stretch it out. Normally, I'll shoot for that 10, 8 to 10 to 12 seconds of video somewhere in there, and then I'll think backwards. So I need 240 frames if I'm doing a 25 second exposure, which is a typical value in a very dark place like a Milky Way time lapse. So you need 240 frames if you have a exposure plus your interval. You know, you give it 2 seconds of buffer on top of it, you might end up with 27 seconds. And so it'd be 240 times whatever the 27 seconds is. That's why it takes a long time. But typically, I'm doing a time lapse somewhere between 45 minutes to 2.5 hours. Also, unless you have a battery grip on these cameras, they're typically going to quit in about 2.5 to 3 hours, somewhere in there.
That's one of the challenges that I ran into, especially because of this weekend I tried to make a time lapse with a Fuji. And I think the Fuji battery ran out after like 45 minutes or something of the time lapse. And that was with me
Oops.
turning off, you know, every option that I could, the replay and the electronic viewfinder, and it still just ran out of batteries really quickly. I was going to ask you about that. I was pondering bringing a big plug-in battery
Vagabond Mini.
like the Vagabond Minis that we use for powering strobes, and then getting an AC adapter for the camera, something that would let it maybe run overnight, because even with the DSLRs, I didn't get more than 4 or 5 hours before it ran out of batteries. Anyway, battery life must be a problem, and I guess most of the time you're probably just standing next to it and you can just swap the battery out quickly if you need to.
Manage it really closely. Typically, I'll know. I'll start with a full battery. I mean, that's just the most obvious thing to start with. You have at least three batteries, basically. Two is good, but three is even better because you maybe wear the one that's in there out. You want to start with a fresh one and then have a ready to go in for your next shot. Or if you're really good, you can actually swap a battery in there while you're shooting and not if you're really good. But I've never used a battery grip, but you can obviously use a battery grip and that'll double your battery life. So that's one way to get around it. AC adapter is fine if you're going to have a extension cord, external power handy. Mostly I just manage it. I actually don't use the battery grip. I might consider getting one for the Canon 6D or the Sony because the night time lapses do tend to go on a while. And there are time lapses at night that I kind of wish I had had that extra battery life. And the shot doesn't go on longer because the battery dies and it's 4 o'clock in the morning and I'm so tired that I'm not really, you know, at that point, I'm not managing myself anymore or anything. I'm just looking forward to getting the shot done and going to bed.
Yeah, I'm imagining maybe you're
But,
camping and you just go to sleep and it dies somewhere in the middle of the night. That happened to me before.
are you typically camping when you take the long exposures or do you just hang
Some
out?
of the places are not places you can camp at. places I was in Colorado most recently, but I did camp there because they gave me access at night, and I could. It was a great, beautiful alpine lake. I've done this in Iceland and also on the Outer Banks in North Carolina, and then also out on the Blue Ridge Parkway and the parks that we have out here in Western North Carolina. So I'm not really camping simply because I'm working. Since 2010, 2011, I've had two cameras. And when you have two cameras going at the same time, it gives you double your output, which is good, and gives you a little bit more margin for error. All that's great, but it does keep you busier. So you're not as idle. You know, you don't have, it's not something you can set up and just go absolutely to sleep, because you'll wake up and either, you know, your gear will be wet, or your motion control gear will be way past its margin, or your camera will be gone. I've never actually had that happen, but I've watched my stuff fairly well. I do occasionally take a little nap or something like that. But to answer your question, no, I'm not normally camping. It is the places I go are normally national parks or state parks, places like that where you could, you know, most of the time you're allowed to be and allowed to be after dark. That's another thing I have to remember, locations.
Yeah, that can be a real challenge around here too. And we're about to take a look at some submitted time lapses. And I know we're going to see a lot of people in their backyard or indoors somewhere, simply because being in one spot for multiple hours is boring, and especially physically challenging. It might be cold, or you know, you might want to do a 6-hour time lapse in New York City, but maybe you don't want to be out at night at 3 a.m. in the middle of New York City, so there can be safety concerns around it too. So it is good to experiment with time lapses in your backyard and get all the technical stuff kind of worked out, get your workflow going. But at some point, yeah, you're going to have to find a location that will let you hang out in the middle of the night so you can get these awesome star time lapses that Daniel kind of puts together. Let's take a look at a couple of time lapses. And Justin, it occurs to me that Daniel might not be able to see it well. But maybe in Skype you can set it up to share the output screen. Skype has a screen sharing feature.
Okay.
So if you can figure out how to set that up. In the meantime, we'll take a look at this first person's time lapse, and I don't know if this is a yard, it could be a park or something, and we see the sky moving overhead, and the lighting is changing really dramatically. We see traffic moving past. Daniel, one thing I want to ask you about is shutter speed. Do you go there? There are a couple of different ways you could do it. I'll back up. Let me ask you about camera settings. Do you go all manual? Do you let the camera auto-expose things? What mode do you use?
Pretty much I'm always shooting in manual. Very rarely am I going to let the camera make all of the decisions, because you're going to get some inevitable flicker of some form. So I'm almost always shooting with manual settings.
What happens when the sun goes behind a cloud and the lighting just completely? Do you just let the picture go very dark?
Most of the time, yes. And the answer to that is your camera really is going to have enough dynamic range to cope with that situation. Mm-hmm. Where it doesn't have enough dynamic range is when the sun goes down completely, or you know, that kind of the typical classic sunset situation.
Yeah.
Your camera will actually handle it'll handle somewhere, you know, I would say somewhere about a dozen dynamic stops or so of dynamic, and that's total, but you're going to have about maybe 5 or 7 that are really usable.
Yeah.
Stops. You can cope for the most part with the cloud type of darkness, but like I said, this is sunset. That's another ball game. So, sometimes I will actually change the settings, my time lapse now. Now that's not something I would recommend for a beginner because they won't know how to cope with it. There is a software tool out there that's called LR time lapse.
Yeah.
Specifically, I would say anybody who's going to be an advanced time lapser that they should look into this product because it helps. It's what's called level and ramping software. You can change your settings while you're recording, while you're capturing, and then it'll help you even all that out later.
That's
just a great tool for knowing, you know, I can either make a mistake or change this on purpose to capture what I want to capture, and know that I can fix it later, and it's not going to make a huge. Like I said, I wouldn't recommend that for somebody who's just starting to capture, who doesn't know what to do with that.
Yeah.
Manual settings are a good way to figure out what's going on with light in general and to deal with, you know, I feel like I'm a master outdoor cinematographer outside of time-lapse now, because I've dealt with all of these different lighting situations from sunset to sunrise, you know, nighttime, et cetera.
Yeah, shooting time lapses does make you have a better, it builds a better understanding of how light changes over a period of time, because most of the time when we take a single photo, we just kind of capture what it is at that particular moment. But when you actually start before sun, watch the sun come up and see how lighting changes, you get a deeper understanding of it. We were just looking at this one.
Something I would add to that, Tony, is that the still photographers, I'm a little bit jealous of them sometimes, because they get capture that one moment in time and can go doctor that up really well in post. Whereas a time lapse, sometimes those tricks are not, like an adjustment brush. It's not something you would use on a time lapse per se, because it's going to move. Whereas the still photo, you can get that one moment perfect, and you don't have to worry about all the moments before or the moments after. If you clip your image either on the highlights or on the dark side, you've lost that data for good. But if you manage using the histogram, is one thing that I would recommend everybody learn how. If you're going to do time lapses, learn how to use the histogram. Right. Otherwise, you're not ever going to figure out how to get your exposure exactly right. And that's my guideline now. That's on all the cameras. That's the one thing that I figured. Right, figure out immediately how to display the histogram with the image review.
We try to teach people that with just regular photography too, because it's an important thing to learn. You have to know how to properly expose any photo.
Yeah, you'd be surprised. It's probably the most common problem we deal with. It's just photos because people didn't look at the histogram. But with the time lapse, you almost have to see into the future. If you're shooting the sunrise, then you know the scene is going to become much, much brighter. And if you are locked in at manual exposure, then your scene is going to be wildly overexposed by the time the sun gets completely up, and you won't be able to recover all those highlights, and it will just be blown. So you do kind of have to think ahead. You also have to think ahead compositionally, because things like the sun, so you can use a tool like Star Tracker on Android. There are a couple of different Android and iPhone tools that will show you the path of the sun or the moon. Yeah. So you can literally predict the future in your physical scene where you are here. I think this first time lapse is good, though. It's a good time lapse, but there's no particular subject to it. We really don't know where we are.
I'd say it's the setting sun. It's a bit.
And there's no like focal point to it. That's kind of. But
it was a nice smooth transition.
Yeah. It's something we all just, it's the way we all start. Here a boat.
Oh, they've sent us multiples within one.
Yeah, that's a good idea.
See, there are some things that you can clone out of your photos, because you can apply the changes to all of your but there are some things, if you have dust on your sensor or something, you can take that out and then you can apply it to all of your pictures in Lightroom and it will take it out throughout all of them. Yeah, any little things, even anything that's still you can change. So a garbage can or something ugly that you don't want in your picture.
Yeah, or you could raise the shadows on the entire set before you export them as a time lapse or export them as JPEGs. And specifically sensor dust is something I've struggled with time lapses. And you can use the little brush tool to clone one piece, but Lightroom's not real smart about it. It'll always copy the same part of the picture over that one spot. So in other words, you could copy from clear sky to clear sky and it will look good in that first photo.
But if there's a cloud, then it might clone it into the wrong place.
Yeah, if the moon then moves through that spot, then you end up cloning a spot of the moon and it can look really weird.
Tony, if I can interject on that,
yeah, please.
I don't have so much trouble with sensor dust as much as you're sticking your lens out there for a long period of time, especially during the bright day time lapses, or any time you put a filter on there, you run a higher risk of getting dust and particles on the outside of the lens, which becomes if you're doing any kind of motion control, for example, but can be a huge problem. You can spend three or four times as much time in post trying to remove that. One of the ways that I combat that now is multiple methods. Obviously, a lens hood.
Yeah.
Keeps. Anytime I don't have to use a filter, I don't use a filter, because a filter, as you know, sticks that piece of dust a few millimeters or a half inch further away from the lens, and makes it more likely to be in the focal area and resolved by the camera.
Yeah.
Dust that's actually on a lens, especially an aspherical lens, tends to not to show up as much if you're focused towards infinity.
Yeah.
But I also carry one of those rubber rocket lens brushes.
Oh, great idea.
I carry one of those with me in my pocket all the time. And before I start any shot, I'm giving it a good rocket blow to get all the dust and everything off of there, so that I start it with a nice clean exterior on the lens.
And but it seems like you could use that.
Those are some of the things that I do. Go ahead.
It seems like you could use that during the course of recording the time lapse too, whereas you wouldn't want to bring a lens cloth and try to clean the front element. You could shake the whole camera, and if you move it even a tiny bit, that becomes a jerky moment in your future time lapse. I'm just thinking that's a good idea.
You have to be careful not to actually stick your hand into the photo, though. But yeah.
Oh, that's, yeah, good point. I assume there's some gap between photos when you can jump in there and give it a little blow or something.
Right.
Are you able to see the time lapses, Daniel?
Yeah, I can see that. That one's really nice.
Yeah, I like that one.
It is beautiful, isn't it? Yeah. And here we have just the setting sun. These aren't long time lapses. I think these are all, you know, maybe an hour or an hour and a half, maybe less. Do you have any particular feedback for this user? I mean, they seem to be great. They might have missed focus on these stars.
For somebody's, you know, some of these are really nice. That one with those mountains and clouds is actually very well done. I wouldn't have too many suggestions for them. It's almost a monochrome scene, but it's high dynamic range. They seem to capture the clouds really well. I'm curious where that location is, actually.
Yeah, it was beautiful.
Yeah, it was gorgeous. Yeah, I wish I had the answer for you. This is Hidden Valley. I don't know where that is. It's hidden.
Okay.
Oh, I think
nighttime lapses are. They don't usually look good from your backyard. So you normally you have to go to either an urban setting, someplace that's you've got lots of blinky lights, or someplace that is literally the middle of nowhere. The suburbs and the in-betweens usually are not very impressive for night photography.
Because
the things
there's too much
that
light
make
pollution.
Good still photographs also make good time lapses. But just if you just appreciate what's going to change over time, you want something that moves. So anything that moves that you can photograph, you can time lapse. I did one that was inside Minneapolis Airport. You guys were talking about longer exposures earlier. I did a 1.6 second exposure inside Minneapolis Airport. That's one of the things that I did. Once upon a time, I was delayed for 3 hours. So why not?
Yeah.
That sounds really cool. And a lack of movement is one issue that I have with this particular time lapse. The sky here is beautiful, but the foreground itself is extremely static. And I think if there were grass moving or, I don't know, anything, that would help a lot. This is also one of those cases where a slider would really help. And I asked you earlier what motion gear you use, and you said you use the dynamic perception stage zero.
That's a great package for somebody to get started with. It's very durable.
Yeah.
It's not, you know, it's relatively affordable, and they're cut, you know, I used to work actually for them and be in customer service.
Still
have great customer service people as well. There is no real wrong answer. There's different other sliders out there. If you live in North America, this is probably the right one for you to get started with. There's the Kessler gear as well, but it is quite a bit more expensive.
Yeah.
I wouldn't really recommend that for beginners. That's more for cinematographers, people who are in the video, you know, professional videographers who want to add motion control. The Stage Zero is specifically designed for time-lapse photography. You can use it for motion control for video as well.
Okay.
But it's built for time-lapse purposes. So they have a Stage One unit also that will fit in a backpack. It's more of a tubular tent type construction.
Okay.
Stage Zero is a little bit more bulky.
That was my question, is how is this to travel with? Because your best ones are in some remote location. So I imagine you don't want 10 pounds of extra gear that you have to carry with you, nor something that would be complex to set up, especially if you got out there at night to take pictures of the stars. It could be really difficult to assemble something complex.
Right. I've traveled with that one on numerous occasions. I have had to find special ways to get it on an airplane and Another solution is the rail. The main aluminum rail there can be ordered from a company called, I believe it's 1080 or 1020, 8020. I'm sorry, is the name of the company that makes the rail. It's actually all of the parts for the Stage Zero, almost all the parts of the Stage Zero are available from third parties. The belt and the rail are both available from third parties.
Okay.
So that means that you can buy any length belt and any length rail from the third party vendor, have it shipped to a destination of your choice. If it's in anywhere in North America, you can have it shipped, and that turns out to be a lot cheaper than taking it on an airplane. So that's what, if you're going to say San Diego and you live in Connecticut, in your case, I would just order the rail, have it shipped to your hotel if you own the Stage Zero. That's one of the things that I've done in the past. So there's actually somewhere in Iceland I have hidden a Stage Zero rail. Let me know if you
can
find it.
It's cheaper to buy it and throw it away than to put it on your airplane because you can't, it's too big for carry-on, I guess, because it's 6 feet long or something.
The rail costs about $42 to $48, depending on what length you have. And it will cost you, as a third bag, minimum $75 to take on an airplane.
Wow.
So
that's funny. That's a really good
tip.
There
are other ways to do it, though. You can buy a ski bag, like a snow ski bag.
Yeah.
Put the rail in that, and then it's just a regular piece of baggage. Mm-hmm. But then you want to pack other things in it, too. So it's,
but you still have to pay for that, usually.
Right, and I've also taken different one thing I like about the Stage Zero is that you can put different lengths of rail on it. So I, when I went to Spain, I took a 3 foot rail. Iceland, I think I took a 4 foot rail. You know, when I went to Colorado, I took a 5 foot rail. The one that I bought with the dolly was 6 foot long. So that allows you that flexibility. That's one reason I really like that is you can do different things with it. It's very versatile. The Stage One is much more of a ready made. Here's what you get. You can really use, you can put it, you can buy additional extensions and make it longer, but it doesn't have the additional flexibility of being able to. Now it's a much lighter unit that goes to the Stage One. These names are confusing, I realize, but the stage one is a backpack type unit. The Stage Zero is more of a, you know, get a longer bag, hike it up the hill sort of thing.
Yeah, that makes a lot of sense.
You have a ton of useful information. We need to do a blog post on this.
Yeah.
And
there is a lot of information
to convey.
Because
I think people will want to go back and see this information in a more organized way, not have to watch everything in between. So
yeah,
we'll have to do that for the viewers.
Well, let's take a look at another time lapse. This is definitely a backyard time lapse. This person has it on some sort of rotating head.
I like
might
this.
Be an egg timer.
I imagine it's the dog's point of view. It's in the fence looking up.
Yeah, there's lots of motion in there. And again, the subject can only be the clouds, and clouds are what they are.
Whoa, it's a bit dizzying.
Yeah,
it's rather creative, though, and they've done a good job coping with the different exposure values. They've used a manual exposure, but they've picked a value that's, you know, in a nice middle range and captures quite a bit of the scene.
Yeah.
There's a fairly big jump between clouds. Would you go for a fast shutter speed like this and leave that jump in movement, or would you consider putting a neutral density filter on there? And, you know, if you're going to take a picture every 30 seconds, try to make a 30 second exposure so that it's kind of blurred but smoother between exposures.
Yeah, that's a good question, Tony. I think that's really a subjective thing, but there's also, as you know, in landscape photography, they consider longer shutter speeds to be generally more aesthetically beautiful. There is a magic value, I think, with clouds and with water.
Yeah.
Where you capture a certain amount of motion. And when you're doing a time lapse, you don't want to have the longest shutter speed you can think of simply because the motion will be so blurred that it won't change a lot from one frame to another. So for example, I was in Spain and I had the Mediterranean Sea in front of me, and I wanted to find a shutter speed that captured the motion of the waves, but also used a longer shutter speed and smoothed it out some without erasing all of it.
Yeah.
What I ended up with, typically with water, you will use a shutter speed somewhere between a quarter of a second and 1 to maybe 4 seconds, somewhere in that range. So that's a desirable shutter speed with water for a time lapse, since you want to show some kind of motion, but you also want the surreal landscape photography part of the longer exposure. With clouds, that is totally a subjective value and also completely depends on how fast the clouds are moving. So sometimes up here in the mountains, we'll get clouds moving very fast.
Yeah.
Even a 1 second interval is almost not fast enough. when you get closer to the further away you are from the clouds in terms of altitude, the cloud altitude and your altitude, the speed also. So, and then also weather is obviously a huge factor. So you just have to judge the cloud motion.
Yeah, no right answer.
I like to have a little bit of blur in cloud motion, but not totally, you know, like a longer than say 8 seconds would be too much. I think would be too long for, maybe not too long, but like I said, it's a subjective value. Yeah. I would err away from, one thing I always aim for in any time lapse is I want an exposure longer than 1/30 of a second. If that makes sense.
Yeah.
And that's a, like a cinematography thing, because I know I'm going to animate it. I want it to animate smoothly and not be staccato when I animate it. So I'm always aiming for at least 1/30 of a second or maybe 1/50 of a second. I always want a value longer than that, no matter what I'm thinking. You can fake that in post, but that's another story.
Okay, good advice. We'll cover a little bit of photo news, so jump in whenever you have a thought. This is a very cool time lapse that Justin has a little video for of the moon passing in front of the Earth. And I just thought it was amazing. This is the dark side of the moon, by the way, the side of the moon you don't really see. Amazing, right? That's all. I just thought,
come on, NASA, step it up.
Super cool.
Come on.
Unless you have
not
some criticism.
That's going to make the flat earthers. Am I right? Look at that.
Oh, yeah. Well, you might be offending a good portion of our audience. It seems
I don't care.
Our audience is mostly flat earthers.
This is one stance I'm going
to
take.
Daniel, I don't mean to drag you into a controversy here, but where do you stand on this, the Earth round or flat?
I'm pretty sure it's a sphere.
Oh, damn, he said it. Oh, you just pissed off a lot of people. Seriously.
There are satellites that tell your phone what to do, and I'm pretty sure they go around and round.
So. Yeah, that's what they want you to believe. Google made this very cool tool that can analyze a sequence of video.
Yeah.
Justin has a little video clip that'll
make more sense. You're always making with
Justin's
the video.
Justin's got everything. That reflections on glass and remove it.
Oh, we need that.
So it analyzes, it has to analyze many different frames so it can tell kind of the difference in perspective and how subjects move and do that. And it can also pull out chain link fences and such.
Amazing. I don't even have to try anything anymore. Google's got me covered.
But there's no way you can use it right now. They've just kind of done a proof of concept and figured out the algorithm. So it's not like you can install this on your phone, but I suspect we will see this in some future version of Android or Google Photos.
I guess it's good if you're in a zoo.
Anyway, pretty remarkable, right?
Great for zoo photographers,
I also found this, somebody sent this to me on Twitter, but this person made a clear camera, at least partially translucent camera, and it's like an old medium format camera. Mm-hmm. I think it uses 4x6 film with a lens that's from like 1870.
Oh, the red glass, like the red light.
Right. So the film that they're using is tintype, and it's sensitive only to the other end of the spectrum.
Yeah.
So it's sensitive to the blues and such.
Yeah.
So they made this red box so you can see the red light, but the film doesn't pick up that particular part of the spectrum. These are just a couple of the shots that he made with it. Anyway, you can find more about it at sdp.io/clara, but it's just a really cool project to see the inside of a camera.
I just like that picture because it looks like his school photo.
Yeah.
But like way too late.
Yeah, that was done with like a transfer directly to paper. Anyway, cool. Just a very cool process. Oh, and we have a new camera.
Always.
This is one people are pumped about, though. This is the Sony A7 R2. And it just came in like half an hour before the show, so we've not gotten a chance to play with it. I did use the autofocusing.
Oh, did it work?
It seemed good.
Yeah?
But, you know, we're going to have to do
a
real
test. We had a big debate in the office because Justin said, are you excited? And I said, it's so hard to be excited because they always promise so much. And if I feel like they didn't deliver what they promised, then I have to deal with everybody like shooting the messenger, basically. So it's tough because it's either going to be exciting for me or like,
It's a once bitten, twice shy type thing.
Yeah.
And Sony overpromises with so many of
their
cameras.
Not just Sony, every single camera.
Yeah, I think Sony is particularly bad.
You do?
Though.
You're going to single them out?
They always tell us every camera has the fastest autofocusing in the world, and then we go to use it, and the autofocusing is terrible. Like, how can they say it's the best in the world when it's almost unusable?
Yeah, they're like, we have 400 autofocusing points, and none of them work.
Yeah. So, we're not saying that this is one or the other. We'll test it out tomorrow and have the video up as soon as possible. I also just wanted to...
If you don't mind me jumping in on that,
yeah, please
one
do.
of the special features with the A7R2, I think, is the sensor is also stabilized. Is that correct?
Yes, and that's something that we have in the A7 II without the R, and I absolutely love it. Because you can put on...
This is resolution and the stabilized sensor.
Yeah, so you can throw on like a 24mm f1.4 prime, which is fast and sharp and great for night stuff, but not stabilized. And now it will be stabilized. Any lens will be stabilized. I love that feature in the A7 II. So I'm glad to get in a higher resolution body. I also want to show off some camera gear that I inherited from my grandfather, who passed away 25 years ago.
Wow, that was
no,
delayed.
35 years ago.
Yeah.
But it's just now getting around to me, and it's just really cool. A couple of 35mm still cameras, full manual, of course.
Photography's in your blood.
A film, super. What is this? What did you say this?
Super 8.
Video Super 8.
Yeah, Super 8.
Super 8.
Super 8.
Justin and I were looking up the film, and we're going to make a very spooky movie.
Oh, that'll be very
cool. It seems like it's the only thing you can make.
Yeah. Nikon announced a new version of their famous 24-70 f2.8 lens. This is like the go-to lens for event photographers and a lot of landscape mm-hmm. photographers. And this new one, I put up somebody else's side-by-side picture. You can see it's substantially bigger than the old one.
Yes.
And the old one was pretty big and heavy. But it has vibration reduction, image stabilization, which I love. I think it's so important to get.
Okay.
And it's probably a hair sharper.
Wow.
They also announced... Sorry?
Not cheap.
No. $2,400.
$2,400.
It's a lot for lens.
So sell the kid you don't like.
Yeah.
And you can get this lens.
They also announced a much less expensive $1,400, $200 to
$500. Oh, yeah.
F5.6 lens VR.
We got to try that out.
Yeah, I am interested in that because especially in the Nikon world, the wildlife lenses at the sub $6,000 range can be a little sparse, a little hard to find. So it kind of fits in a sweet spot there, and I know people will like that zoom range. Fuji announced an updated version of the X-T1, well, an alternate version that is an infrared camera. So if you aren't familiar with infrared photography, I know Justin has a little clip of
this
an Audi ad.
This is only infrared?
I think it's full spectrum.
Okay.
So that's my understanding, is they've just taken off the sensor, the filter that filters out infrared.
Oh, I'm liking this video clip.
This is not filmed with the X-T1.
What?
It's just a demonstration what infrared looks like. We don't have any sample pictures from it. So I don't think people necessarily know what infrared looks like. So I wanted to show an example.
They know.
And this is a very cool example.
Wow.
Anyway, if you do get a full spectrum camera like that, but now that I think about it, but you can put in filters that will block out all visible light.
Women and cars and lens flare. I need it. I need it. I think that's kind of stupid.
I also wanted to show off the work of...
Our friend made an infrared camera.
Who's
Chris.
That? Oh, he made one? I thought he just bought that. Did he actually get the filters removed?
I thought he got the filters. I think he removed the filters.
Yeah,
maybe I'm misremembering.
One nice thing about the X-T1 IR is I think it's $300 more than the standard camera.
Oh, okay. So.
And usually, if you want to get the infrared filter removed, it's like a $750 process.
Wow.
It's expensive. So it's actually a pretty good bargain.
Okay.
And because of the electronic viewfinder, I would think you'd be able to just use the electronic viewfinder. Because remember looking through Chris's infrared camera, and you look through the viewfinder, and it was blank?
Justin.
Like you couldn't see anything because your eye can't see infrared. So the fact that it's a...
Oh, I didn't even think of that. Can you get Daniel back here?
Yeah, I just heard that.
Danny, can you hear me? Natalie. Natalie.
Natalie Croquet or Croquette? Check out her work at sdp.io/spoof. But Natalie did a series of photos where she as a model...
She's amazing.
...mirrored famous pictures with models.
How did she even, get... What is happening?
She did. These are two separate photos, of course. That's Natalie on the left, and this is a famous photo of a model on the right.
So did she... Is this Photoshopped at all?
No, I believe they're not Photoshopped.
So how did she get, like, the same exact shirt?
She put a whole lot of work into it. A whole lot of work.
She is insane. This is amazing.
And it is. I think... Just showing off the amount of work that and how perfect she is, down to her fingers and the positioning of her fingers, I think is pretty amazing. But I also
What's
think
going
it's
going on. Are we still live, Justin?
Yeah, we're live.
We lost Daniel for a bit, so Justin's pulling him back up. That's all. But I think it's also a terribly, because one part that she misses is, I think the point she wanted to make is, I don't look like a model, and therefore physical appearance is going to make these pictures different.
Is that, are you sure that's her point?
Well, it's art, so there are many different ways to interpret it. And I think that's the way a lot of people are interpreting it. I'll put it that way.
Oh, that's what people are saying.
But I also wanted to make the point that there are differences that aren't the physical appearance of the model, like their expressions and the way they carry themselves. And these subtleties are the differences between a good model and a great model. And this picture kind of shows it in the model's expression. So if you look at Natalie, her expression is almost blank. But if you look at the model on the right,
Giselle.
Oh, that's Giselle.
Yeah.
I don't know the names of models. But she has a much more intense and focused expression. Her lips are parted a little bit. So her face is much more deliberate, even though Natalie has copied almost everything.
Yeah. I think what people don't like to acknowledge, because models are so objectified, is that it's really hard, like, thankless job.
Yeah, it is a skill. It is not just being pretty. And that's kind of what I wanted to bring up. My spin on her work is, the original models have done more than just be thin and pretty. They've also...
That helps. People want to see pretty people do anything.
Definitely.
Yeah.
But there is more to it. And this is just another good example. You can see she's copied it almost perfectly.
She's incredible, right? Down to the light and everything.
Yep. They pretty much exactly mirrored the light. And I know that took a lot of work. But is this Giselle too?
Yes. She loves Giselle. We all do.
Look at the positioning of the legs and that front leg, and just the way she tilted her foot to show off the heel. And that's something that Natalie missed. She didn't get the silhouette of the shoe just right, but that makes the photo. And also the way the entire knee here is exposed and the lines that are formed by her legs is some brilliant modeling. And no doubt the photographer deserves a little bit of credit there too. But also her head is tilted to show off her jawline, and that's a small point that Natalie missed. I just thought it was a great example of how hard...
Why you gotta be so tough on Natalie?
I admire Natalie's work. That's part of why I'm showing it.
Look at Natalie. She's amazing.
Yes, but Giselle here is an amazing model.
She's a really
And there's
good
more
model,
to it than the way she looks. It's the fact that she knew her angle and to show off her jawline by tilting her head just like that.
She knew
to expose her knee.
Yeah.
I try to give models credit for their skills whenever possible, because not many people do that. So that's why I wanted to show
that. I think in training models, we've met a few people and we've tried to train them as models, and it's always really difficult for me because you have to be painfully aware of yourself. You have to know that one side of your face is less attractive. You have to know that one tooth sticks out a little bit more. Maybe your chin isn't strong. You have to know every single little thing for your body and contort yourself to make up for that. So people think models are naturally attractive, which they are. Like the most beautiful people in the world,
right,
contorted and lit and primped and dressed to look even better. So it's like, it's definitely difficult.
And Giselle here clearly knew what her knee was going to look like on camera and what her jawline. So she could imagine herself from the perspective of the camera and tilt her chin just a little bit. And I'm sure she got feedback from the photographer, but much of that comes down to just
the
model.
You know what blows my mind about Natalie? She knew what kind of wood was in the background. Natalie was like, that's a soft pine.
Yeah,
then Natalie went out and she got that.
Yeah, it is pretty remarkable.
I'm loving Natalie today.
Well, let's take a minute to plug our sponsor, Squarespace.
Oh, yeah, Squarespace. If you have a website and it looks crummy, if people go to it and they say, dude, your website is crummy, or if they go to it and they say, it's good, or if nobody goes to it at all, you might need Squarespace. Super easy to set up. It's beautiful. It's simple. They have great analytics. They have 24/7 customer support. And we love it, so maybe you will too. So you can go to squarespace.com/Tony and code PHOTONEWS, get 10% off your entire purchase. I think you're gonna like it.
Beautiful full screen interfaces that work great on mobile devices. There's never a problem with navigating the user interface because everything is so intuitive. And last week we reviewed some non-Squarespace portfolios, and one thing we consistently had trouble with is just figuring out the user interface. Because Wix and every other site out there, they're just not as refined. Squarespace has amazing designers. So you don't have to be a super nerd because they are super nerds.
I wouldn't say that. That was rude. Oh my gosh, Squarespace.
I'm taking the word nerd back.
Oh.
Daniel, do you consider yourself a nerd?
Big sigh.
I don't know. I'm pretty technically savvy. I'm kind of more of a geek because I was raised to believe that that was a more desirable word. The geeks got laid and nerds didn't, I think. I think it's how it goes. So,
but see,
that's
for
probably
me,
changed now. I think that's actually totally changed.
So, for me, a geek is into like Star
whatever you
Trek.
Want to be now and still get laid. So,
I think everyone can get laid if you set your standards low enough. That's how I'm weighing in on that issue.
Yeah, clearly somebody is sleeping with these nerds, right? To me, the difference is that nerds are into like Star Wars and comic books and stuff.
Yeah.
Or no, geeks are into Star Wars and comic books and stuff. And nerds are like the more productive variety. We're into
See,
figuring
I
stuff
that,
out.
I had that backwards. So maybe, I don't know. I really don't know.
I thought.
But yeah, one of them can fix things and one of them is just, you know, into geeky stuff.
One of
know.
Them just lives with their mom. No offense.
Another cool aspect of Squarespace is they give you these awesome analytics. So you can log in and you can see exactly how many page views you get and different time spans. So it's a great way to see if you've been promoting your site on Twitter or something, just how effective that's been. And that can really help you narrow down various advertising and outreach efforts.
Oh, it's going to make you crazy when you see people look at your on the first page and then they're like, something else, cat.
Yeah, so I can see that almost everybody finds my site via Google. That's Google and the big pie here.
Oh, yeah.
And then this other chunk is people visiting my site directly, maybe because they saw it here. And then things like Facebook, even though we're pretty big on Facebook, it's a much smaller portion of the overall pie. They give you everything you need to make an awesome website. They make it easy to do. If you decide you want to just check out Squarespace for 14 days, visit squarespace.com/Tony. And then if you decide to sign up, use the coupon code PHOTONEWS, and that just, we don't get money for it. That just lets them know that you heard about it here, and maybe they'll sponsor.
Maybe they'll keep sponsoring our show, despite my reckless drinking.
Let's take a look at a couple more time lapses. I bet this is somebody's hotel room or something, right?
Looks like a hotel room.
Yeah, because it's not, I don't think anybody's like, oh, I really want to do a time lapse of the local Toyota dealership. So a lot of time lapses, because they take so much time, you end up choosing the location based on your own convenience rather than what's more beautiful.
Can I say what I like about this one?
Yeah.
The view of the clouds, you're almost like at their level or something. Cool.
Yeah, I do like the way the composition is split, and the movement of the clouds is really compelling, especially when you get these god rays kind of shining through it.
Yeah.
So the clouds themselves are really cool. You have any thoughts, Daniel?
Well, one of the thing about rails, we were talking about sliders earlier, any kind of rail structure, lattice structure is extremely good for slider moves, because you can set that up so easily to move from one position to the other, and you have partial visibility, which is excellent for any kind of motion control. Okay. This person probably doesn't have that type of equipment, and this is a fairly nice time lapse. Otherwise, it's well exposed. The transition from light to dark is pretty smooth. I don't know how they did that exactly. But that's the only thing I would add, is this would be an ideal situation for motion control.
You know what? Can I just say that I miss Siobhan?
Well, let's check in with Siobhan.
I want to check in with her, and I just want to see how her life is going.
Siobhan?
No, you don't.
Our screen over in Philly.
I knew you would have questions
for
me.
And Siobhan's dog. What do you got for us, Siobhan?
Well, Mr. D'Amlo some questions first.
She's very quiet to me, Justin. Is this just me?
I'm here. Am I being quiet?
Yeah, I can turn her up.
Okay.
Okay.
How about this one? What is the longest elapsed time you've done time-lapse photography? Ever went as long as an entire day?
What do you think, Daniel? How long have you done time lapses?
No, I have not personally done that. I have a couple friends, a friend of mine named Doug Urquhart in Atlanta. He has done season-long time lapses and set up solar panels and done lots of crazy things. I have not personally done that. The longest ones that I've done are pretty much two battery life on a Canon camera, which is about 5 to 6 hours.
I imagine Daniel measures all time in battery life. He's like, honey, I'll be back in 3 battery life.
It's actually in frames. How many frames do I have? Do I have enough frames yet? Can I go home?
Siobhan, what else? Speak to us.
I've got lots. Do you prefer time lapses in the city or in nature?
That should be pretty obvious by my work. I actually prefer time lapses in nature, but I do have the intent. I consider city time lapses to be a little too easy. I hope nobody's offended by that remark, but there's a lot of light. There's a lot to work with. There's a lot of motion, and there's a lot of subject material, and it's very human centric, narcissistic, so to speak. So,
Daniel,
you know, that's easy pickings for a photographer. So there's lots of things moving and lots of bright lights, flickering lights. People like that. That's why we like Christmas time, I think, or lots of reasons why we like
that.
What
do you have against Christmas, Daniel? What do you have against Christmas? And this like? Is this like the low hanging fruit in the time lapse photography world? Like you're like people.
All I'm saying is that people like blinking lights and flashing lights, and so cities, when you time lapse them, that's how they look. There's lots of blinking, flashing lights. I'm not saying I don't like those time lapses. I'm saying that we live in an urban society. That we have a large percentage of people who live in the city or in places where that's accessible. And the other thing is, from a photography point of view, the Milky Way and the dark sky outdoor time lapses are considerably more challenging for the equipment and for the photographer than the urban time lapses.
Wow. I like that you're just like, the challenge is also exciting for you. Because what I was going to do was sit in the city, and then I was going to get 1,000 models in bikinis and just have them marching in and out of the frame.
Yeah.
Because I like to pander.
That's definitely not a time lapse. I'd say slow motion video for that.
I like the pandering.
I think
what
Daniel's work is just too easy. That's why I showed the one of the moon.
Yeah.
Because for me, it's all outer space time lapses now.
The thing I don't like about Daniel is he stays very much on this planet.
Yeah, it's just too easy.
I'm like, come on, Daniel. Come on.
You know you've been doing it for a while and you're like, yeah, the time lapses are just too easy. Sitting in one spot in the middle of a city for 6 hours, it's child's play.
Yeah.
I need to be out in the middle of nowhere.
One consideration with urban time lapses is your personal security and how long do you want to stay in a place that maybe is, you know, at night, in a place that might not be so pleasant to stay or might have a, you know, interesting local pedestrian life.
Yeah, that's a good point.
And one challenge I've had is people will just walk up and get right in front of your camera.
Absolutely.
And what do you do? Are you like, no, this section of the sidewalk is mine. So you really have to frame out a place where nobody's going to bother you.
Time-lapse dog. We could sell it at Northrop.photo. Uh-huh. A seemingly vicious dog that circles your tripod.
That's a great idea, Chelsea.
Write it down.
Time-lapse dog.
We're going to want this later. Sorry to hijack the question. Siobhan, anything else?
Of course. What program do you use for editing your time-lapses?
Good question.
He just said this.
No, we have not talked about this.
We have not gone over this yet.
It's a good question, though. Well, you did mention LR time lapse.
Oh, okay.
That's true, but that is just really an accessory to the whole Adobe suite. So
yeah.
That's pretty much what I use is the Adobe suite. For a long time, I used Lightroom to make. Generally, what I'll do is I'll get the photos into either Lightroom or Adobe Camera Raw. Then I will render out JPEGs or TIFFs or whatever I feel like that day. These days I'm rendering out JPEGs. I'm rendering out full size JPEGs. Then I'll pull that into Adobe After Effects to animate the sequence. When I pull it into After Effects, that's when when I grade the photos in Lightroom or in Camera Raw, which really there's not a huge difference between Lightroom and Camera Raw except for interface and convenience. There are a couple other things. You would actually know more about that than I would. But if you don't have the money for Lightroom or you've got, you know, an older version of Adobe or whatever, you can do 98% of what you need to do in Camera Raw. After Effects is great for all of the animation, for the video part. I actually do all of my work in After Effects. I don't even bother with Premiere these days. I at some point, I probably will have to learn Premiere. But I do all of that stuff in After Effects. And you can do motion blur, add motion blur to short shutter speeds, for example, is one of the things you do in After Effects. Pan and scan and post, all of these things are really, really useful in time-lapse, in the animation process. And I consider that part of the art form as well, is not only can you take a good still photo and it moves over time, but then what do you these days when I'm out in the field, I almost can see the final product. There's some of the stuff that I did in Colorado, I could actually visualize, I'm gonna take a still photo, but then I'm gonna pan and scan across that image. I was thinking of that while I was doing capturing.
Okay, let's take a look at a couple more reader submitted time lapses. This one shows I'm guessing this is in a backyard because we see multiple homes here. But it's a pretty beautiful time lapse, and I love the way you see the stars just moving. This is a holographic projection to make you think that the Earth is flat.
Yes, and the government will
or make
do
you
that.
Think the Earth is round.
The government tends to do that.
Yeah. But it looks beautiful to me. I don't see the stars in the clouds, but I think it turned out good. Do you have any particular feedback? It looks like the shutter speed was pretty long.
I've done a bunch of stuff like this with the moon and the woods when I was getting started.
Yeah.
All the, you know, experimenting with all of that stuff, you'll, as you do dark sky, night photography, is a huge, huge factor and can govern when you want to go out and when you don't want to go out. So, for example, one of the dates that we have highlighted on the calendar soon is we have the Perseid meteor shower. This is going to be a big deal for night photographers.
Right.
And one of the deal, one of the reasons it's going to be a big deal is we have a relatively dark moon. We're going to have a new moon on, I believe, August 14th, mm-hmm. and the meteor shower, or I might have that backwards. We have a new moon on the 11th, and the meteor shower peaks on the 14th, or vice versa. But within 3 days, we have a new moon and a meteor shower peak. The Perseid shower is one of the larger, is actually one of the larger meteor showers, more predictable meteor showers. I would advise, if you're a night sky time lapser or think you want to be, that's one of the events you can go out and capture here in within a week or two.
You know a true night photographer when they just know the moon phases.
Yes,
and the
I was thinking that. He knows the moon personally now.
Yeah.
I'm kind of cracking up at this time lapse.
My mistress eyes are nothing like the sun.
I like
Poseidon.
Poseidon.
Or Neptune.
Using a turtle as a turntable. As you do.
DJ Neptune.
DJ
scratching
Neptune.
It off.
He's got some killer abs. And I love just the people just doing, well, it slows down. This guy's like texting. And that drives through. It's very Benny Hill.
Yeah, this one has jumps.
Yeah, there's a few jumps.
The camera changes positions. Sometimes deliberately, but also I think the tripod might have been a little bit wobbly. And yeah, I think they stopped and restarted it several times with gaps in between.
I find it compelling.
I do find it compelling.
But it's we'll also a bit like I can't, I want to watch it again just because there's so much.
At first, there's a long shutter speed. They started with a long shutter speed, and so you see blurs, but then they use a faster shutter speed, and we're doing it like more frequently.
Well, there's like, I kind of like, there's a statement being made unintentionally, intentionally, I don't know. But you always have this beautiful landmark, and then there's just like people riding by in a golf car. Like, that's what happens. You're like, I'm going to see the Eiffel Tower. And then you go there, and there's like a homeless man peeing. You're like, this wasn't in the pictures. That's what I think when I think of this time lapse. It's just, ugh.
I think this would be a good part to talk about maybe hyperlapses. That's one of the things that the technology is allowing now is with the cell phones and cameras. Once you've mastered sort of a basic time lapse and understand what's going on there, the hyperlapse is a way that really is, you can expand on your skills and do something really exciting. It's much more challenging, but you don't need any special gear. All you need is a tripod, and any camera is capable of doing this. You know, take a photo and move 1 foot, and take a photo and move 1 foot. And obviously you have to keep the same subject composed in a way that moves smoothly. So typically you'll line up a tall building or a tree or a point and keep that in exactly the same place as you move. Mm-hmm. Now I have done this stuff. No one has seen it. I have not made put any hyperlapses out there for anyone to see, but I did some of those in Spain inside the buildings and they're really, really cool. They have a lot of potential. Other people have done them much better than I have done them. But that's one of the things for somebody who's maybe, you know, done cloud time lapse, but I don't really want to spend 500 gear. Hyperlapse and moving the camera in very small increments on the tripod is one of the things you can do. It's very labor intensive and requires quite a bit of time sometimes in post to work all the wrinkles out, but you can do it without a great deal of investment in gear.
Yeah, we'll have to dedicate a future episode to that.
Wait, I liked that last one.
That's one thing that I still am working on myself, and it's a frontier for exploration for myself.
Here's a time lapse close hanging at Microsoft Ignite.
I like it. It looks
like a
commercial.
And they did a zoom in post, which I think helps.
Yeah.
It's because when you take still photos like this, you end up with far more pixels than you need, especially at a 1080p video. So Daniel's talked about this, but you can zoom in, you can pan and move around.
Yeah.
All within the captured frame. And that's one thing I liked about the time lapses I was making with the 5DSR is I can zoom in like 500% and still have a sharp picture and then really pull way back.
So
So
our
they added a little bit
last,
of that
I
zoom in.
just
It
want to bring
helps.
up this. Our last one, there were people that were a bit distracting. They were distracting from the landmark. Whereas this one, they're part of the story. The faces are all blurred. They're not doing anything that's standing out, and it's kind of a part. It's a part of a story for me. I like this one. It's simple. It's kind of commercial to me. Like I could see that being stock footage or something.
Yeah,
But
about what's happening
yeah,
there.
I like that.
It's a nice color combination and nice composition.
Yeah, I thought so too.
This one's literally labeled Hotel Window, but they got a beautiful hotel. And also, getting a good time lapse is a great excuse to spend more on your hotel room because it's practical now at this
Yeah,
point,
tell
right?
your wife that.
I have made hotel reservations based on the view, absolutely.
Oh, me too, and I've made them based on the room for stock photography.
Sometimes you get a well-decorated room and you want to actually use it because the hotels are clean, whereas your house probably is not that clean. So this is beautiful with the fog rolling through. San Francisco is a great location for that. That adds some movement to it. The colors are too yellow for me. That bumps me a
You
little.
always like to cool it down. I know that about
For
you.
night photography, I do. But I think the movement here is I think an easy way to make this more compelling would have been to shoot with a wider angle lens and then do a little of that panning, zooming and panning a little bit
Okay,
in
just to add
post.
more movement, make it more dynamic. I could see that. America.
This is America? Oh, because of the big flag, obviously. I just didn't recognize the tower. Compositionally, this is really nice. They picked a nice spot. You can see people walking through.
It's slightly overexposed in the clouds.
Oh, really?
Yeah, that's what it looks like to me though, but I'm looking through two different compressions, so.
Yeah, I don't. It doesn't bump me. It doesn't feel overexposed to me. But yeah, I know
Maybe
you're.
in the upper right corner.
It's close. I like this. What do you think,
For the
Dennis?
flag movement, yeah, you would, if during the daytime, you're absolutely going to have a neutral density filter. And so for time lapse, or really a lot of situations, cinematographers will carry, for example, a variable neutral density filter that will somewhere between one and nine to give you between one and nine stops of darkening power,
Yeah.
so to speak. And that is incredibly useful for water photography and, water, anything that you want to create an artificially longer, and crowds as well. Crowds is something that is very useful for a neutral density filter.
Here we have just a gorgeous time lapse that's defined mostly by the movement of the sun and the clouds. And of course, they had to anticipate the movement of the sun and the clouds, and they might have taken a lot of different time lapses before it really worked out. But I just love the God rays that kind of come through
Yeah.
and the movement of them. I think this one's absolutely gorgeous. They were clearly shooting with a very contrasty scene, and I think they must have had to really recover those
I was
shadows to get
thinking it
some
looks kind of
contrast out.
HDR-y.
Yeah, I think they must have done some of that.
HDR. Nice.
Yeah, I think that's beautiful. What do you think, Daniel? Other than adding some motion in, which I think always helps. Any
It's very
thoughts?
nice. I'm trying to figure out what if I know this city or not, but I don't recognize it offhand.
It's Atlanta. I know that only from the
Oh,
file
okay.
name,
That's
which
what
it
I
shows
thought, yeah.
there.
I lived in Atlanta for 14 years, so I thought I recognized the buildings. What I don't recognize is where that location, that particular location is.
Yeah, they found
But
a
yeah,
really good
it's
spot. We have something with a rotating camera head. And just kind of showing mostly a beautiful night sky. I felt like this was going so great, but then the place it finished kind of had these random obstructions that hid half, a good chunk of the frame.
backyard syndrome again.
So you have to kind of think about if you have any kind of movement, you have to think about where it starts and ends. But I think the way the I think all your camera settings and everything look great. Beautiful scene.
One of the challenges with rotation that we could speak to right there is you don't want to rotate the camera too fast. One tenth, if you have, for example, the dynamic perception gear or any of the other gear, one tenth of 1 degree is as fast as you want to rotate, or
Okay.
possibly even slower than that. Because if you, when you take the next shot, the video codec, it wants to stitch that together. It doesn't want, it wants limited amount of change in each frame. if you have too much rotation, too much change in each frame, it'll just jerk basically and create a very staccato image, which is just not at all pleasant. So if you're ever doing a rotating time lapse, overcompensate on the side of slow rotation as opposed to just don't do anything faster than 1/10 of 1 degree per shot.
Good advice. And we're looking at Bill Pepa's own time lapses here. He's one of our favorite people.
I love Bill Pepa's.
And he has, well, first they're gorgeous, but he's also stitching them together with a nice smooth cross dissolve, which I think that particular type of transition works really well with time lapse. But it also means that you need to pad each time lapse seconds to give yourself time to just, you might think, so that you can blend them from one to the other.
This one's a bit dark.
Yeah, he's kind of stitched together a best of here, and it's a pretty long reel, but some of these I would raise the shadows on. And you know, advice that we give with a lot of portfolios is just kind of make it just your best, and some of these are not up to the quality of the others.
The Pepa standard.
Yeah. I think these with the clouds are really compelling. As night falls, we lost the Pepa standard.
Can you believe it's 6:15 already?
Oh my God, we always go late when we have a guest.
What else do we have to get through here?
I think we got through. Oh, we had a poll that I never plugged, so we can't do that. Siobhan, do you have any other questions for us before we head out? Siobhan, or maybe we lost Siobhan.
Possibly.
Oh, that's so sad.
Justin, did you have any good tweets?
No, not in particular. Sorry, okay. I was just scanning over them.
You as an audience have failed us today by not making any good tweets. Please try harder in the future.
I'm really disappointed.
We'll take a look at a few more time lapses here. This one
you
is...
You need a better looking guest, that's all.
Wow, Daniel taking it personally. This is a different type of time lapse. This is a very long-term time lapse where we can see...
our Earth dying?
Hey, it could just be going from winter to... to summer, but we have been seeing these a lot for kind of showing global warming.
Yeah,
we see a lot of fluctuations in the light, but if you're taking still pictures at the same time every day, the light's going to fluctuate because there'll be a cloud in front of the sun or something.
Ooh, this one's really fast,
so you will get this kind of blinky. Well, I think it's happening, like, I think it's a one photo a day type thing.
Oh
yeah, this is a very challenging scenario in terms of animating it, because you're obviously going to have flickering no matter what you do. You're going to have to use some type of auto exposure value on the camera. Right. It doesn't look like they did any real post magic and post in that. You can use frame blending, for example, will reduce the flickering. LR time lapse is another way you can reduce flickering. It has a deflickering tool in there. There you can also use Adobe After Effects color stabilizer. It's one of the things that you can use if you just have After Effects. It's a built-in tool in After Effects called Color Stabilizer. It'll ask you to identify a part of the screen that you don't want to flicker, basically, and it'll try to stabilize on that one thing. Now, that's a little bit lower quality tool than using if you really want no flickering whatsoever, LR time-lapse is, again, probably the way to go.
We'll check it out. This
Joe
is
Baker.
Joe Baker, right? Very cool. I wonder if he had a housing or just huge balls.
What?
Either way, it turned out.
Pardon?
Well, because he put his camera out. I love that.
Yeah, I was thinking of the danger to the camera too, but I wasn't going to phrase it that way.
Yeah, Daniel's.
He is in Texas,
no,
and people
no,
from Texas have
just
huge balls.
That way.
Everything's bigger in Texas.
A beautiful composition here, too. This makes me think of Breaking Bad. One reason I'm interested in time lapses is you see it used a lot in cinematography right now. And Breaking Bad had a lot of time lapses.
Hannibal.
Hannibal used.
When we were in DC, we saw two guys that were doing a time lapse for a show. They said they couldn't name the show, but then I stalked them. I think it was like the Real Housewives of something or other, but they were making a time lapse.
Yeah, and you're doing some of that work, right? Daniel, I've just been looking at your website. It looks like you're at least open to commercial work.
Yeah, absolutely. I've done a couple different shoots for a documentary, someone else's feature documentary. I've worked on commercial shoots at the Biltmore state nearby. I've done a couple different things. The time lapse is not as if probably if I lived in New York or Los Angeles, I would experience more demand for that type of thing. Most of the local people here don't know the difference between video and time lapse and don't understand the specialized applications. I am obviously selling stock footage. I'm trying to get myself out there, and I'm very open to anybody that would want that type of services commercially.
Yeah, well, we have a varied audience, so maybe if they see you, they can spread the word of Daniel.
Yeah, what was your website again? I have a slide
for
it.
It is starmountainmedia.com.
Starmountainmedia.com.
I'm doing other things now besides the time-lapse thing. We didn't really get into that today, but flying two drones and doing 4K cinematography with the Panasonic GH4.
Yeah.
Just trying to
I was checking out that stuff,
out
too.
My skills.
I saw you with that Nebula. We have one of those that's gathering some dust because we didn't have a whole lot of luck with it ourselves, but that's a conversation for another day. We saw a still photo from this set or from the same location this week, if you recall.
Yeah, I do.
And we liked
actually.
It a lot.
I recognized it.
It ended up being a beautiful photo or something that a still photo couldn't, which is the movement of this particular.
That's amazing.
Yeah,
I didn't know that was a thing.
Yeah, and that's one of the great things about time lapse is they show that extra element, and they can be just so much more engaging than a standard still photo. Here's one where people are really the scene, and again, a pretty ballsy location right between trolleys, though maybe they only turn around there. I guess they don't ever go past them. But a great composition, a great place for movement, Budapest. I love this one. I think this, I'm giving that one 5 stars.
Oh my gosh.
And
great.
A pick.
Do
you think that's
Budapest.
Just really cool?
Yeah, I think it's cool.
It's very strong. It obviously has a resemblance to the Beatles.
Abbey Road.
Album cover.
Yeah, the way it's so square.
Right.
Bay Bridge. Kyle Wolf, a good friend of ours. Good job, Kyle.
Wow. Gorgeous scene. I know you think this is a layup with the city lights and stuff. I think it's absolutely gorgeous.
Yeah, it's well done. It's absolutely well done.
This is almost a perfect example for when you're just doing still photos for night photography, the difference between the blue hour and not the blue hour, because look how gorgeous the sky is here. And then as the sun goes down, the sky still gorgeous, but then, an hour after the sun's completely down, much more boring. This as a still photo is so much less interesting than that as a still photo.
Yeah.
And that's just why we tell people constantly to get out a little earlier when they're taking night photos before it's even really feels like night. But as a time-lapse, gorgeous composition. And
yeah, that's one of the things with time-lapse is you definitely have to get out there a little bit earlier and prepare because you're not just capturing one instant in time. You're going to capture the transition from one moment to a completely different moment. If you don't spend the time out there and can capture the light change, if you don't get out there early enough. One thing is you don't really need to arrive 2 hours before sunset. You need to arrive, 30 minutes before sunset and stay 30 minutes after sunset is usually how I plan to do it.
Yeah. I love this one.
Good advice. Yeah, this one is just gorgeous, mostly because you can see the movement in those clouds.
The reflections, the colors.
There are a few odd flickers in it, and it sounds like...
Yeah, it looks like they've used automatic values, and that would account for the flickering.
So switch to manual mode. Could even fix that in post if they knew the right tricks.
That's correct.
Lightroom has an option to equalize the exposure of all your pictures, so even in it
yes,
could pull
it
up.
However, if you are using a manual lens, it doesn't capture the aperture value. And I don't know about the newer versions of Lightroom, but older versions of Lightroom, if you don't have an aperture value in the field, it's unable to equalize the exposures. So you have to do that manually if it doesn't have an aperture value.
Good point. Assuming you're using like an autofocus lens that can show it. We're running over time here. Did we get Siobhan back? Is Siobhan gone?
I assume she just bailed. I have no idea. Wow. She just dropped out of the chat. Hopefully she's okay.
Something came up. I'm sure Siobhan's fine. She can handle herself. We'll take a look at a couple more, but we don't have any more comments from people, so we'll wrap it up pretty soon. This is another gorgeous spot with just clouds racing through the sky. I love this shot because of the multiple layers of, and I'm sure there's no way they could plan this, but they...
It's really beautiful. I like the low angle.
To use, just as it would be in still photography.
It kind of doubles your action, right?
Yeah, you're right. Yeah, that was a really compelling one.
Oh,
You know what? I'm going
what?
back, give that one a 5 stars.
I see a man.
Yeah, this one's going to be great, I think.
I like it. Unlike anything we've seen today.
I mean, I don't know why you're saying you see a man. We don't know how he identifies. We see a person. Here we see a little bit of flickering going on in here.
Wow, we've really got
It's
an
a
impressive amount.
good choice of subject, not necessarily good execution.
Yeah.
It might be the way they sent the file to us because it looks like I see a lot of like banding and
It does, it did
I
come
think this is
across that way
automatic settings
compressed.
again.
But yeah, I think the flickering and such is caused. I have no idea what's going to go on in this time
Me.
lapse. Oh, well, this is cool. Yeah, this is almost an instructional time lapse.
Oh.
Actually, it's
Oh
more
my
like
gosh.
stop motion.
Oh my gosh.
That's very creative.
Yeah, I've not seen a time lapse like this.
It's making me hungry.
Wow.
Wow.
Cool.
I'm
Not at all what I
going
anticipated.
to their house for dinner.
Lake Geneva. You see a boat trucking through.
Trucking.
Very gray day. Not
Oh.
an especially dynamic scene.
Low clouds, yeah.
Yeah.
We were speaking a little bit about hyperlapses earlier. There's a guy named Rob Whitworth. He has done these hyperlapses now in South Korea and Barcelona. You might want to consider him as a guest one day. He's done taking it to the next level as far as the surrealness of the moving moving with a tripod through space lapse world.
Oh, I'll definitely check that out. I don't know that much about hyperlapses. I only have a little familiarity, but I'll check out his work. Thanks for the recommendation. This is beautiful, the way we see the clouds kind of coming out. I think the whole thing might be a little
That's what I
underexposed.
was going to say, but it's nice.
Pretty easy to fix, but I think it's a nice scene.
Corn.
Yeah. Also nice, maybe a little short at just 6 seconds. That was kind of the minimum you recommended.
This is the Samuel Beckett Bridge.
Ah, yes, it's a beautiful spot, and I don't know if you've been there, Daniel, but at this particular point, I've never seen so many night photographers. And we just went out on like a random Tuesday, but there were like seven other night photographers there. It must be
Yeah.
the most popular spot.
Where is the Samuel Beckett Bridge?
It's in Dublin, right?
Dublin, yeah.
Yeah.
In Connecticut.
Dublin, Ireland, I'm sorry.
Oh, I'm sorry. Okay.
No, Connecticut has
Another
nothing this striking.
one of the places that I went that was filled with night photographers is Arches National Park in Utah. I think I met three of them, and I think there were eight that came through.
Yeah.
So Arches, if you go to Arches, just be ready. There's a lot of people there at night.
Yeah, that's a pretty famous spot.
I just got a text from Siobhan that says, I spilled beer in keyboard.
Oh my God.
Siobhan.
Siobhan. How uncouth.
I spilled beer in
She
keyboard.
can't even write full sentences at this point. She's like Homer Simpson.
There are risks when you drink during a live show. It's a terrible combination. I don't know why we chose this formula.
Oh my God, she is the worst luck,
Like a
though.
live
Just in
broadcast is.
general, it's insane.
Yeah.
She's breaking everything.
Her dog has wrecked her computer a couple of times too.
Her husband?
Yeah. That's a loose
We have to
cannon.
put her computer in a bubble. Goodness, Siobhan.
Would you believe we got through all the time lapses?
I believe it.
I don't think we've ever gotten through all the photos before. Justin gave us a round of applause.
Thank
So
you, Justin.
we will head out. Thank you so much for joining us, Daniel, and thanks for the free lessons in doing time lapses. You can learn more about Daniel at starmountainmedia.com,
Yeah.
and you have a YouTube channel, amazing time lapses. We showed clips from some of them. You have some great videos on Vimeo, and you can follow Daniel on Twitter and stuff. His website, his about page has lots of links and stuff. So thank you for
Thank you
joining
so
us.
much for having me, guys. I really appreciate it. Come
Yeah,
back anytime.
anytime, and thanks for all the information.
So
We
much
could
information.
have filled 5 hours with just pulling info out of your head, I think. It takes years and years to gather that kind of experience. So I appreciate you sharing it so openly. And we'll talk to you
No
soon.
problem. Thank you very much.
Thank
Take
you,
care.
Daniel.
See you
Bye.
Thursdays at 5. See you next week. Oh, what's next week's theme? Action.
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 Next week, action. Bye, guys.
Bye-bye.
Bye.